I genuinely don't think this world understands the cost of following Jesus. And I will say this over and over and over again because I get so many DMs asking, what do I do when people make fun of me? What do I do when my friends judge me? There are people in other countries dying for this faith that you have fully at your hands. They're weeping in persecution while you're sitting here watching this video. And you're so scared to move on with your faith, to give God those things that you're struggling with, because you don't want to lose friends. You don't want to be judged. And somebody asked me the other day, do I ever get scared of being judged? I get judged every single day. And you're judging me watching this video right now. But Luke 9:62 says, no one who puts his hand on the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. So when you accept God, don't take it lightly. Don't take his love for granted when people are dying for it. So when you're seeking God, stop looking back in the opposite direction. Taking steps backwards will never get you to your final destination.
What happened in that moment only happened because God allowed it. Not that God wanted that for you. Not that he wanted you to be in that situation, or that he wanted you to carry that grief or carry that pain or carry that shame, but God only allowed what he knew you could survive and what he could ultimately redeem. That means that if it happened to you and you weren't in it by yourself, God was there. That there was something that was happening in that moment that God said, even as bad as this is, even as terrifying as this is, even as scary as it is, I hope that person remembers that I'm in it with them. Because if I'm in it with them, that means that I can redeem whatever took place in that moment. I feel like that's somebody's word right now, is that you have to recognize, no matter what you have gone through, no matter what you have faced, if God allowed it, it's because he said, you can survive it and I can redeem it. What does it mean to be redeemed by God? It means
there are people that you have to let go for the next place that God is calling you to, because God has not given them clearance to go with you. See, sometimes God makes a decision and we keep fiddling around and playing around in our emotions because of how we feel about a thing or how we feel about a person. But one thing I've learned about God is he doesn't bend by our emotions and he doesn't bend by our feelings. He is God. But at the end of the day, it's going to be exactly what he said. Time's up. Oh, glory be to God. Don't you mourn over anybody that God has moved out of your life. Don't be like Lot's wife. Don't you look back. Don't mourn over them. Don't try to figure out why. Listen, straight ahead, because you have purpose, you have destiny, you have an assignment. Keep your heart pure. Love God. Love people. Let them go.
Well, I hate to say it to you guys, but I told you so. Check this out. I lost over 700 followers in 24 hours. I also just recently posted about my new girlfriend, and actually my first girlfriend ever. It's a pretty big deal for me. A long time ago, I said, if you're just following me for my looks or that you're attracted to me, then unfollow me. And so many people denied it because I personally believe that most of my followers follow me for the things that I say and the things that are inspired by the Holy Spirit. But I know that I have some followers that just follow me for my looks, and that makes me sad. And my hypothesis was right. I don't think it's just a coincidence that I lost 700 followers as soon as I posted my girlfriend. Guys, I'm making a point here. Are you following people because they're helping you get closer to God? Are you following people just because you think that they're attractive? Just because they have a good jawline and say that they're Christian doesn't mean that they're worth your time. I challenge you today to do a heart check.
Have y'all ever heard of the theory of general relativity? It's what Einstein is famous for. In his calculations, he started to realize that the universe was not eternal. It had a beginning. Now this leads us to the law of causality. Everything that came to be needs a cause. So Einstein clearly knew that if the universe had a beginning, it needed a cause. Let's go to the Big Bang Theory. There was no space, no time, and no matter before the Big Bang. The universe emerged out of nothingness. What does that mean? Since it's impossible for the universe to be able to create itself because it didn't exist in order to be able to create itself, nature and the universe itself was just a big effect that was caused by, what are we left with? An extremely powerful, extremely intelligent, precise, given the precision that our universe was created with, personal entity that is capable of existing outside of time, space, and matter. that can't be nothing but God. And for people that are like, okay, well, how do you know that it's like Christianity's God? There's only one God. But there's a very famous astronomer named Robert Jastrow. His credentials as a scientist are impeccable. Being agnostic, he's not even a Christian. He said that all of the essential elements of the Big Bang Theory line up with biblical creation. Because this is how God works. God speaks something, and then science runs to catch up with what he said. Science doesn't create anything. Science studies creation. Let me just answer a question that I always get. Who created God? What'd I say? I said everything with a beginning. Everything that came to be needs a cause. God didn't come to be. God is eternal, the way a lot of people thought the universe was until science disproved it. So God doesn't need a cause or a creator. He is the cause. The universe is the effect. Don't just take my word for it. Go look into it for yourself. One more thing. Evidence is not a substitute for faith. Following God is not a matter of evidence or proof. It's a matter of the will. You have to want to do it so you can have the peace that you're looking for. And if you don't want to make that choice, no amount of evidence is going to convince you to. You have to want to. This ramen bowl about to be busting. People always ask me, if God is real, why do all of these bad things happen? First thing, God gave us free will so that we can love him and it actually be real love because we chose to do it. When it was just God doing his thing, everything's perfect. There was no death. Lions were laying down with lambs. There was peace. When humans decided to take things into their own hands and not really obey God, this is where it's led us. All of these crazy things happening in the world. We give ourselves the credit when it's something good that happens. And then we blame God for the bad things when we are the reason. Let's talk about this too real quick. God is fair. And since sin is sin, if he punished one sin on sight when it happened, he'd have to do that with everyone. Imagine if God punished every sin on sight, we'd all be dead. God wants everybody to make it to the kingdom. He wants us to come to him as we are.
Y'all, stop letting these fake Christians on TikTok influence you to make you believe that it's okay to live a lukewarm lifestyle. I seen this audio that said, like, I'm from the hood, but I love Jesus, so that means I could lay hands on you, but I can still pray for you. Like, no, that's not how that works. You don't get to go out committing a sin and then say, oh, God knows my heart. You're right. God does know your heart, and that's what you should be afraid of, because it ain't no secrets when it comes to him. These folks that's out here influencing you, they're not going to answer for you in the end. You're going to have to answer for yourself. Christ is not giving access into the kingdom to the people who are on the fence about their faith. You pick a side and you stay there. We are fastly approaching on the time of tribulation, and Christ said that he is only allowing a remnant into the kingdom. A remnant does not include lukewarm. A remnant does not include non-believers. A remnant does not include yes and no people. It is time to get serious about your faith. If you are really trying to enter into the kingdom of God, it's too late to be playing.
What your Bible says about you. If your Bible looks like this, you're either super sanctified and Holy Spirit filled, or you only go to church on holidays. There's no in between. If your Bible looks like this, you love wearing long flowy skirts and hats, and you're definitely super obsessed with Sadie Robertson and definitely part of a small group. If it looks like this, you're either actually a teenager or over the age of 25 and you don't want to buy a new one because one, you're just too lazy, or two, it has all your highlights in it and you're not trying to get rid of them. And if your Bible looks like this, you definitely are always early to church and you always have a pack of mints on you. And even though it's in this case, your Bible is still like really torn up.
This is not going to be one of those pretty feel-good messages, because I'm gonna be honest right here, right now. I have not wanted to be here lately. I have not seen a purpose in living, and I know that sounds bad and awful to say, but I've been undergoing so much spiritual warfare lately, it's insane. But the thing is, we're sitting on this parking deck, and I'm here with my friends, and we're talking about God. And I've been leaning so much on my own understanding and thinking that I'm not in a worthy place to be making these videos. And that's when I actually see a helicopter take off, and it's an emergency one. It's for some kid or some person that needs God right now, and I'm sitting here asking God why I'm alive when that person is begging for their life. See, you don't see the purpose that God has for your life, or maybe you're struggling and that's why you're watching this right now. But this is so hard for me to admit, but please know that you need to stop leaning on your own understanding and let God take control. Trust the Lord with all your heart, even when you feel like you're going through warfare, even when you're going through pain. Know that he's greater than anything you're facing, and take a look at the people around you and realize you aren't alone.
Here's a hard lesson I've been learning. The things that you can do for other people, or how good of a friend, boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, wife, whatever, does not dictate how valuable you are as a person. Now, don't get me wrong. Being kind to other people is a very important quality and attribute that all Christians should carry. However, I often find myself finding my worth and assurance in who I am as a person based on what I can do for other people. And you want to know why doing that is so incredibly toxic? Because one day I'm going to disappoint the people in my life. One day I'm going to fail them. And even if they eventually forgive me, I will not forgive myself. I feel like we become so used to this idea of conditional love, constantly having to do things or be good enough in order to receive love, that we forget about the unconditional love of the Father. And I'm learning that our identity and our assurance should be in His love. Like, it's crazy to think about the fact that I'm valued and cherished because I am His child, and not because I'm like a perfect best friend or daughter.
There's a man in the Bible named Solomon, and he wrote one of the most iconic love stories, Song of Songs. And what's ironic about that is that Solomon ended up getting married 700 times because every relationship he was in couldn't fill the hole in his heart. He goes on to write Ecclesiastes, which is one of the most depressing books of the Bible. And in Ecclesiastes, he says that the Lord has put eternity into man's heart. And what he means by that is that there's this hole in our heart that only the Lord can fill. And there's way too many people out there that are filling that hole with people and wondering why they still feel empty and wondering why every relationship they're in continues to fail them. And it's because you're filling it with things that the Lord never intended it to be filled with. And it's gonna keep coming up short. But if you would just turn away from all those desires that you have and turn towards the Lord, He's gonna redirect your path and He's gonna fill your life with so much meaning you can't even imagine it.
We didn't go to church, but I got blessed.
My rent was gonna be laid up about a week ago. I worked my ass off.
John 14:15, the Lord says, if you love me, keep my commandments. So all this, the Lord knows my heart, save it. You may have love for the Lord, but you love what you're holding on to more. You may know the Lord is real, but you don't understand the depth of how real the Lord is. A lot of y'all can't grasp eternity. Your mind percentage isn't expand enough. People hold onto material and physical things, letting that get in their way of coming to God. People make worldly excuses not to spend time with an eternal God. Do you guys not know there is coming a time where there will be no more time? There is coming a day when you take your last breath and there will not be any excuse for you. There will not be no, but Lord, you knew my heart. No, the Lord said, if you love Him, you will obey His commandments. Listen, there won't be any excuse when you are in front of a perfect and holy, just God. And the Lord's been patient with you. You are still breathing. You know how many people passed away that wasn't living with God? And they still aren't.
Hey bro, is it a sin to kiss before marriage? First, it's important to not only have physical boundaries, but also emotional boundaries in dating. A boundary is a line that you've set up that you're not gonna cross. The Bible is clear about needing to have a boundary around not having sex before marriage, but what about kissing? Two questions. Can you kiss without lusting after your boyfriend or girlfriend? Second thing, can you kiss without being tempted to cross other physical boundaries? You should never ask, how far can I go with my boyfriend or girlfriend? You need to ask, how can I best flee sexual temptation in the season before marriage? I hope that helps. Follow for more.
I want to talk to the ladies for a minute, my sisters. I was reading through the book of Ephesians chapter 2 this morning, and it reminded me of something so powerful. Jesus's blood initiated autocorrect over our lives. Therefore, we need to remember, when the world looks at us and says disaster, Jesus says no, daughter. When our sin says rags, nothing but filthy rags, Jesus says no, riches. When the enemy looks at us, when he looks at us and says mess, what a mess she is, Jesus says no. He says absolutely not. She is my masterpiece and forever will be my greatest creation. She is fearfully and wonderfully made. Never forget your worth in Christ. Never forget how precious you are in His sight. And always remember that Jesus gets the final word in defining who you are.
God woke me up 2 nights ago at 4:00 in the morning and said, I am going to give you a dream. You must wait 1 day until you tell anyone so that you may understand. Please forgive me if I have to make multiple parts because I'm going to try to talk fast. In this dream, I was living in a pristine white mansion, and we were having a housewarming party, And then suddenly all of these people were like, hey, everyone, look outside. This is so cool. I opened the front doors and the entire front yard was covered in a foot deep of water and thousands and thousands and thousands of frogs and one large frog in the center, which was 8 foot tall. Everyone was mesmerized by this. They spent the entire night outside playing with these frogs in the front yard. In this dream, I had to get ready for work, so I went to my room. I put on deodorant. Sounds so irrelevant. But as I put on deodorant, the time passed from 5 o'clock in the morning to 7 o'clock in the morning. I was supposed to be at work at 7. I don't have time, so making part 2.